Hello friends, today we will discuss about our last topic of this chapter, that is MCG, moving coil galvanometer. Right, now friends, first of all, what is the use of this galvanometer? So you already know that galvanometer is used to detect the current, right? So the moving coil galvanometer, or we can say galvanometer, so the MCG, moving coil galvanometer, is used to detect the current and to measure the voltage. Right? So the moving coil galvanometer, or we can say galvanometer, is used to detect the current and it is used to measure the voltage, or we can say potential difference. Right? Now, the construction of this galvanometer will be like this. Here, this galvanometer consists the coil which is rotating in the magnetic field. So this is north pole and this is south pole. Right. Now this moving coil galvanometer consists a coil which is free to rotate in this magnetic field, and this coil will be like this rectangular in shape. So this coil is free to rotate in the magnetic field. Right. So here we also place one iron cylinder like this. So this iron cylinder makes the magnetic field radial, right? So to make the magnetic field radial, we use the iron cylinder like this, right? Now here, this galvanometer consists a spring. This spring is attached to the pointer which shows the measurement. So this is the mechanism of the galvanometer. First of all friends, what is the use of galvanometer? So galvanometer is used to detect the current and it is also used to measure the voltage, or we can say potential difference. Then the galvanometer consists a ring, or we can say a coil, which is free to rotate in the magnetic field. So this galvanometer consists a coil which is free to rotate in the magnetic field. Now here, this galvanometer also consists one iron cylinder which is used to make the magnetic field radial. Now it is also consists a spring which is used to produce a counter torque. Right. So here magnetic field will be there. So we already know that here, if the area and magnetic field is at 90 degree, then we already know that here torque tau is equals to NIAB sin theta. Right. So here the magnetic field is radially. So we can say that the angle between A and B is 90. So here theta is equals to 90. So maximum torque will be NIAB sin 90. But we know that sin 90 is equals to 1. So maximum torque will be NIAB. Right. Now we also know counter torque which is proportional to the angular deflection. So if angular deflection is 5, then we also write like this, torque tau directly proportional to angular displacement 5, right? So this torque is due to the spring, because we know that the spring produces a counter torque. So this torque proportional to the angular deflection. So here the constant will be spring constant K. So tau is equals to K phi. That is equation number 2, right? So see friends, equation number 1 and 2, by comparing this equation 1 and 2, so from 1 and 2 we can write that NIAB is equals to K phi, right? So here if we formulate angular displacement phi, then phi is equals to NIAB by K. N number of turns, I current, A area of this coil, B magnetic field, and K spring constant. So here N, A, B and K are constant, only current will be changed. So here we can also write like this, NAB by K into I, right? Because N, A, B and K, these all are constant, only current will be changed. So here we can also write that phi directly proportional to current I, right? Once again friends, what is the use of galvanometer? So galvanometer is used to detect the current, and this will also use to measure the potential difference, or we can say voltage. Now this galvanometer consists a coil which is free to rotate in the magnetic field. Here there is one iron cylinder like this which is used to make magnetic field radial. Now here this galvanometer also consists a spring which is used to produce a counter torque, right? So here the magnetic field is radial. So if the angle between K and B is 90, then maximum torque is given by NIAB, value of theta 90, so sine 90. We already know that sine 90 is equals to 1, so maximum torque tau maximum, or we can say tau is equals to NIAB. Then the spring will produce a counter torque, so tau proportional to phi, so tau is equals to K phi, where K is the spring constant. So here we compare equation 1 and 2, so we will get NIAB is equals to K phi. So if we formulate phi, then phi is equals to NAB by K, but NAB and K all are constant, so we can say that phi directly proportional to current I, right? Now if you want to find out a formula of spring constant, so from this equation number 2, spring constant K is equals to tau by phi, right? So what is the unit of this spring constant? So the unit of this spring constant is joule per radian, right? So the unit of this spring constant is joule per radian. Now we will discuss about current sensitivity and voltage sensitivity. Now what is current sensitivity? So angular deflection per unit current is known as current sensitivity. So first of all friends, we will discuss about current sensitivity. What is current sensitivity? So angular deflection per unit current is called current sensitivity. So angular deflection, we denoted angular deflection by phi, and per unit current, so current sensitivity will be given by like this, current sensitivity is equals to angular deflection, that is 5 per unit current. So current sensitivity is equals to 5 by I. Now see friends, this equation, phi is equals to NAB by K into I, right? So we know that phi is equals to, we know that phi is equals to NAB by K into I, right? So what is current sensitivity? So current sensitivity is the angular deflection per unit current. So phi by I. So here we take I to left hand side. So we get phi by I is equals to NAB by K. So what is the formula of current sensitivity? So the formula of current sensitivity is phi by I is equals to NAB by K. Right. Now we will discuss about voltage sensitivity. So what is voltage sensitivity? So voltage sensitivity is known as angular deflection per unit voltage. So angular deflection, that is phi, and the as per the definition, what is voltage sensitivity? So voltage sensitivity is known as angular deflection per unit voltage. So phi by V, right? So to prove the formula of voltage sensitivity, we already know that this equation, phi is equals to NAB by K into I. So once again friends, we know that phi is equals to NAB by K into I. So what is the formula of voltage sensitivity? So voltage sensitivity is equals to phi by V. So here we divide this equation by V. So dividing by V. So we get phi by V is equals to NAB by K into I by V. So here we divide this equation by V to get voltage sensitivity. So phi by V is equals to NAB by K into I by V. But friends, we already know that, see here, V is equals to I. So here I by V. So if we formulate I by V, so we get I by V is equals to 1 by R. Right. So here instead of I by V, we can write 1 by R. So the voltage sensitivity is given by phi by V is equals to NAB by K instead of I by V, 1 by R. So what is the formula of voltage sensitivity? So voltage sensitivity is equals to NAB upon KR. Once again friends, what is the use of galvanometer? So galvanometer is used to detect the current, and it will also used to measure the voltage. Now this galvanometer consists a coil which is free to rotate in magnetic field. Here we place one iron cylinder to make magnetic field radial. Here this galvanometer also consists a spring which is used to produce a counter torque, right? Now we already know that tau is equals to NIAB sin theta. So if the angle between A and B is 90, so maximum torque NIAB is sin 90. Sin 91, so maximum torque tau maximum is equals to NIAB. Now we already know that the spring will produce a counter torque. So this counter torque is directly proportional to the angular deflection phi. So tau proportional to phi. So tau is equals to K phi, where K spring constant. So if we want to prove the formula of spring constant, so K is equals to tau by phi. Now we compare equation 1 and 2. So by comparing equation 1 and 2, we get NIAB is equals to K phi. So phi is equals to NIAB by K. but we know that N, A, B, N, K, this all are constant. So N, A, B by K into I. So we can write that phi proportional to I. So the angular deflection directly proportional to the current. Now we will discuss about current sensitivity and voltage sensitivity. Now first of all, what is current sensitivity? So the angular deflection per unit current is called current sensitivity. So current sensitivity, angular deflection, that is phi per unit current, so divided by I. So to derive the formula of current sensitivity, we already know that phi is equal to NAB by K into I. So here we take I left hand side, so phi by I, that is current sensitivity, is equal to NAB by K. Now what is voltage sensitivity? So angular deflection per unit voltage is called voltage sensitivity. So voltage sensitivity is equal to phi by V. Now again friends, to prove the formula of voltage sensitivity, we use the equation phi is equal to NAB by K into I. So here we divide this equation by V. So dividing by V, we get phi by V is equal to NAB by K into I by V. But from the Ohm's law, we know that V is equal to II. So if we formulate I by V, then we get I by V is equal to 1 by R. So voltage sensitivity is equal to phi by V is equal to NAB by K, and instead of I by V, 1 by R. So voltage sensitivity phi by V is equal to NAB by KR. So friends, you have to remember this equations of voltage sensitivity and current sensitivity. The equation of current sensitivity is NAB by K, and the equation of voltage sensitivity is NAB by KR. Right? Now, here, what's the use of galvanometer? So we already discussed that it is used to detect the current and it is used to measure the voltage. Now, we can also use the galvanometer as an ammeter, but there are some problems. We cannot directly connect the galvanometer in series. Why? Because here, if we connect a galvanometer in series, so this is like this, this is galvanometer, this is the resistance of this galvanometer RG, right? Resistance of galvanometer. Now, if we connect this galvanometer directly to this circuit in series, then what happens? So there is an addition of resistance. So we already know that if the resistance increase, then there will be a problem, right? So we cannot directly connect the galvanometer in series because it will increase the resistance of circuit. Now, to overcome this problem, we connect one resistance parallel to the galvanometer. This resistance is known as shunt. So what is shunt? So shunt is a resistance which, or we can say shunt is a resistor which is connect parallel to the galvanometer. Now what happens? So here the shunt having resistance less than the galvanometer, so most of the current passing through this shunt, right? So the problem is overcome, right? So once again I repeat, we cannot use galvanometer directly as an ammeter because if we connect galvanometer in series, then what happens? There will be an addition of resistance. Then other problem is like this galvanometer is very sensitive to the low value of current. So to overcome this, we connect one shunt, or we can say one resistor which have a lower resistance as compared to galvanometer. So we connect a shunt in parallel to the galvanometer, and the resistance of this shunt is less than the resistance of galvanometer. So what happened? So most of current passing through this shunt, right? So the problem occurs that which I discussed earlier, that problems are overcome with the use of this shunt. Right. Now what happens? If we want to derive equation of this shunt, so here total current will be I. So here at this point, see, this is point A, this is B, this is C, and this is D. Right. So here total current is I. At point A, this current will be divided into two parts. So current passing through this galvanometer is IG. So the remaining current which is passing from this branch AD will be I minus IG. So this current will be also I minus IG. Right. So total current I, but at point A, this total current will be divided into two parts. So current passing through this galvanometer is IG. So remaining current will be I minus IG. Now to prove the formula of shunt, see the loop A, B, C, D. So for loop A, B, C, D, A, right? So here we apply Kirchhoff's rule to this loop. So here we already know that, see, first of all, from A to B, the direction of current and the direction of this path also same, right? So here we are going to A to B, current will also in the direction of A to B. So potential difference IR will be negative. So minus current will be IG and resistance RG. Right. Now B to C, nothing will be there. Now C to D. So we are going to C to D. See the direction of current. The direction of current is from D to C. So here the direction of current is opposite. So potential difference is positive. So here plus IR, but current I minus IG, and resistance will be RS is equals to 0. We have to find out the formula of shunt. So here we formulate RS. So I minus IG into RS is equals to this IG RG goes to right hand side. So IG RG. So we get RS is equals to IG RG upon I minus IG. So the formula of shunt is IG RG upon I minus IG. Once again, friends, we cannot use galvanometer directly as a ammeter. Why? Because if we connect galvanometer directly to the circuit, then there will be an addition of resistance. And another problem is the galvanometer is very sensitive to the small value of current. So to overcome these problems, we use a shunt parallel to the galvanometer. So this shunt having a resistance RS which is lower as compared to resistance of galvanometer. So what happened? So here we use shunt RS parallel to the galvanometer. Then what happened? So this shunt having lower this resistance. So most of current passing through the shunt. Right. So our problem is overcome. So as shown in figure, friends, see here. At point A, total current will be divided into two parts. So current passing through the galvanometer is IG. So remaining current will be I minus Ig. Now to derive the equation of shunt, consider a loop A, B, C, D, A and apply Kirchhoff's rule. So we are going to A to B. The direction of current will be same A to B. So IR will be negative. So minus Ig, Rg. Now from B to C nothing will be there. Now C to D. So we are going from C to D, but the direction of current will be opposite, D to C. So IR will be positive. So plus current I minus Ig and resistance shunt Rs is equals to 0. So here we take Ig, Rg to the right hand side. So I minus Ig into Rs is equals to Ig, Rg. So here we formulate Rs. So Rs is equals to Ig, Rg upon I minus Ig. So friends, you have to remember this equation of shunt. The equation of shunt Rs is equals to Ig, Rg upon I minus Ig. Now, what is the equivalent resistance of this circuit? So friends, here you can see that this Rg and Rs are connected in parallel. So the equivalent resistance of this circuit will be R is equal to. Here there are two resistors Rg and Rs. And we already know the parallel combination of resistors. And we know the formula of equivalent resistance. R is equal to R1 R2 upon R1 plus R2. So here equivalent resistance R is equal to R1 R2. That means Rg into Rs upon R1 plus R2. So Rg plus Rs. So here the equivalent resistance of this circuit will be R is equals to Rg Rs upon Rg plus Rs, right? So here this is the discussion about galvanometer as a ammeter, right? Once again friends, we cannot use directly galvanometer as an ammeter. Why? Because if we connect galvanometer in series with the circuit, then there will be an addition of resistance. And another problem is galvanometer is very sensitive to the low value of current. So to overcome this problem, we connect the shunt in parallel to the galvanometer. So this shunt having lower resistance as compared to resistance of galvanometer. So most of current passing through this shunt. So our problem will be overcome by using this shunt. Now to derive the equation of shunt, consider one loop A, B, C, D, A and apply the Kirchhoff's rule. So by applying the Kirchhoff's rule, we get shunt Rs is equals to Ig, Rg upon I minus Ig. Now, what is the equivalent resistance of this circuit? So here Rg and Rs are connected in parallel. So parallel combination of resistance, we already know the formula. Equivalent resistance R is equals to R1 R2 upon R1 plus R2. So equivalent resistance of this circuit R is equals to Rg Rs upon Rg plus Rs, right? So if I say this shunt having very low value of resistance, so you can easily neglect this Rs. So the formula will be like this: R is equals to Rg Rs upon Rg, right? So friends, this is the discussion about the galvanometer as a ammeter, right? Now we will discuss about galvanometer as a voltmeter. Now we use the galvanometer as an ammeter by connecting it into the series. But here the connection will be like this. For lower value of current, we connect one resistor which is series with the circuit, right? So we can directly use galvanometer as a voltmeter, right? For this, to decrease the value of current, we connect one another resistor in series as shown in figure. So what happened, friends? Here series connection will be there. So here equivalent resistance R dash is equals to RG plus R, and we already know that V is equals to I R. So current will be I is equals to V upon R dash. So R dash is equals to RG plus R. So here if this value of resistance increase, then value of current decrease, right? So we can directly use galvanometer as a wattmeter. For this, to decrease the value of current, we connect one another resistor as shown in figure. Then what happens? The equivalent resistance R dash is equals to RG plus R, right? So current I is equals to V by R, but the resistance will be RG plus R. So here, if the value of resistance increase, then we can say that current will be decreased, right? So friends, this is all about moving coil galvanometer, then current sensitivity, voltage sensitivity, then galvanometer as an ammeter and galvanometer as a voltmeter. Okay friends, thank you.